Van.
I'm Chris.
And we are Geek Chic Promotions, and we have the amazing Henry joining us.
Hey.
We are live from the Top Cow booth. How's
yeah.
Going?
Good. Good. Having a good time in Vegas, you know, gambling,
yeah,
drinking,
the dream,
smoking.
You know. Doing the do.
We were actually a little upset because we could not find anything in the vicinity that sold alcohol anywhere.
So we have no alcohol, but cheers with you guys. Sorry.
We're not out there in the lobby.
So cheers to you guys enjoying this. Hopefully you guys have a good beverage with you, whether it's adult or not. So cheers to you. Today we figured we talk with Henry about what kind of the silliest and most annoying questions that we get at a booth at a convention.
Yes. Might actually get a little substitution. Henry might have to jump up and actually help somebody at this booth, and Matt Hawkins, who's standing right behind the camera, will hop in and take his place.
Yeah, and this will be good for everybody, because if you guys want to rage about it yourselves that have exhibited at shows, you can comment, or if you have questions of proper convention etiquette, go for it. And also comment if you can hear us, because we know it's very loud in here.
Yes.
Yes, all right, so let's talk about conventions.
I mean, you meet a lot of amazing people at these shows and people that are really passionate. And I do about 2 shows a month, and I get this, it's almost like I get the same conversation over and over. It's always, how's your show going? And I just know that they don't care, or they just don't.
Or also, you can never just, say it's going shitty.
It's just like when someone goes, hi, how are you? Like, you automatically answer, I'm fine, how are you?
Yeah.
Because, what are you going to do? Like, unload on them?
While we're doing programming, we get that question a lot. I'm like, how's the show going? And I always respond with, it's always great. With a big smile. Yeah, it's always great.
And you always talk to the person that's not having a good show. So when you say, oh, I'm having a good show, and they're like, oh, well, I haven't made any money.
Let me tell you.
And you're just like, oh, I'm sorry that happened to you. Please move on with your life.
Yeah, see, now when this happens to you, do you get people like to just stick there and talk your ear off like forever and never buy anything and then you can't like leave to go help with anything? Just like, how do you handle that?
I do what I do is I say, give me a moment, and I go over and then I talk to somebody and just let them, and then they either get the idea and say, oh, I'll be back, or they stay. You know, comics has a really weird magnetic like autism thing, or like there's like everyone's on the spectrum, you know.
Everybody's socially awkward at best.
Yeah, and I'm definitely on the spectrum.
I feel like we've never said that publicly.
No.
Like we all know it. Just no one ever says it.
We all say like we're socially, they're socially awkward.
Yeah,
socially
it takes a lot for a person to talk about fictional characters and capes and stuff, and I could definitely do that
all day.
And there's some people that are much better at it than me.
Well, okay, here's my thing. Now, I've been doing conventions for a decade or longer. And honestly, I usually don't mind like talking to people at the booth. Like, actually, it's one of my favorite things to do, because people get to express to you how much of a fan they are of something that is there on your table, or like whatever it is. But what I don't like is when the conversation ceases and they just kind of stand there blocking everything, just like kind of happy to be there. They're like, I just had a great conversation and I'm just going to bask in it. And you're just like,
my favorite.
Hi, Eric. What's going on, buddy?
Hey, Eric. My favorite thing is when you're talking and then they just walk away.
Yes!
And I'm just like,
oh my God.
That's the end of that conversation.
So for everybody that's just joining, we're talking about at conventions kind of con etiquette, when you're running a booth or you're exhibiting, kind of the craziest stuff that happens.
Yep.
And that you're just like, talk, and they just walk away.
And we're here at the Top Cow booth talking with Henry.
Yeah, we're at booth 415. Yes. Please swing by.
Yes,
Matt Hawkins is here.
Yes.
And Henry actually watches the show with us.
I do.
Usually, so you guys might know him if he comments.
I have to admit that sometimes I'm driving and it's really dangerous to watch.
That is a bad idea. We do not endorse
that. I'm dedicated. I'm a dedicated viewer.
We appreciate that. So Eric is asking, how's the show going?
Like,
how's the show?
Yeah.
Oh, Eric,
it's
you should rewatch this.
Honestly, he said having fun there was the question. Was the actual question.
That was really
well
funny.
Well, it's a great show. This is me and Chris's first time being at the amazing Las Vegas convention, and it's super fun.
Yes.
Everybody,
it's
is
very
really
comics focused, very independent creator friendly.
Yeah, it's very comics friendly.
And
yeah, definitely.
Like, super enjoying it. And honestly, like, when you see a lot of people you know, so it makes it even better. You know, it's like same friends.
Yay.
Yeah, like this guy. So, and right now we're just kind of chatting about annoying things that you get when you are working a booth.
Yeah, or my other favorite thing that I hate is, how much is this and the price is on it?
Well, you know, they want to get a deal.
Yeah, yeah,
they're hoping
you're
going to be like, oh, it's 50% off.
Oh, yeah, or they try to haggle you. Like,
they're trying to haggle you.
I don't mind that. I don't mind the haggle part, but...
Do you haggle?
I do. At cons, I try to.
Especially on Sunday when you're trying to get
a deal. On a Sunday.
You're allowed to do that?
You heard it here, folks.
Here? No, but like outside of here, I haggle. But I try to work with people. We do deals and stuff.
You do.
Yeah.
Okay, so if it's Sunday, do you guys here at Topco have the whole idea of like, look, the less we bring back, the better? Or
no, we actually, I'm driving, so I can bring back as much as I want.
Okay. All right, that's good.
So you can't crack this.
You're like, this is pro.
Yeah.
We're a pro here.
I'm doing 10 years. This my neck in July is my 10 year
really?
Anniversary.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
I think I'm at 14.
Oh,
well.
Nice. You should be proud of that.
I skipped one in the middle there. Only one, though. There was one that I was like, can't do it! And
ooh.
I, like, stayed back.
Yeah, I skipped one.
Yeah. This is kind of a nice... And, like, Eric was saying that he would love to go, but he can't afford a plane ticket to come out. It is nice that it's local for us LA people. But this is a nice warm-up for San Diego. We have, like, 3 weeks before San Diego. I mean, for us, we have Anime Expo next week, and then San Diego. It's a lot. It's a lot. But this is nice.
Also have amazing Hawaii.
They do,
and I will 100% make them my thing. I've never been to Hawaii, and I want to make that
it's
happen.
It's very beautiful. The people are awesome there.
I hear the food.
I really, the food, even the 7-Elevens, like you go in the States here, like here, you get like ugly hot dogs or like heated like pizzas, but in Hawaii, it's Japanese. You can get can get like sushi and dim sum and. It's
I want
amazing.
To go there. They catch it and they do it right there and serve it.
It's so
amazing.
Good. It's so good.
I want to go to there.
So do you guys do that one too?
We're trying to. Jimmy.
Jimmy,
make it happen.
Hey. Because obviously you're watching.
Right. Well, let's get Matt in here so he can tell you
what's
up.
Yeah, let's get
Matt. Hey, Matt, tag in.
Tag in.
Oh, I'm waiting.
Here, he's got it. He's got to wake up. And it's amazing.
Matt Hawkins.
Hello, how are you? It's going fantastic. I love comic shows. I love them so much. I do 20 or so a year.
Yes. Actually, and you're one of the busiest people I think I've ever met doing the con circuit. How many do you do like a month?
One or two.
Just one or two a month?
Yeah. I've done four, and I'll never do that again. I don't think I'll ever do more than two in a month. I need space.
Yeah.
Like I did three last month. I did three, and they were each weekend.
Well, what's crazy is that like you are making these comics. It's not like you're just here to sell them. So it's like you have to have time to actually make the comics.
Actually, your time during the week.
Well, that's what airplane rides for.
Drink
a couple cocktails.
These type of
ready.
Things. Yeah. When like people come up and they talk to you and they want to like are interested in your stuff, do you have like a routine that you go through for each and every book?
Yeah, I did when I was doing it. Yes, I have what I call my quick 10-second pitch, which is usually the Hollywood mashup. You know, it's like, oh, this is Northern Exposure meets Twin Peaks, and they're like either like, what's that? You know,
and you're like, never mind.
Yeah.
But
you know, I what I try to do is I try to get the book in their hands, I try to get them through the book, and then once they do that, I tell them about it, and ask questions, and try to do that. So I usually, if I can keep the person there and talking to them about it, and they ask me a couple questions, I usually.
Make a sale?
Yeah.
Is it like draining on you sometimes? Like,
emotionally? No, you know, I've been doing this long enough to where I'm used to people not buying. So, you know, most people don't.
Yes.
So it's fine. But, you know, you just do what you do. And I've been doing it long enough. And, the convention circuit is probably about halfway. So,
absolutely.
It's all so many books because there's so many places that there are not a lot of comic shops anymore, you know.
Right.
So people buy these books on the road and they want to get them signed, and you know, I would prefer that they start buying them on Amazon or stores or comic shops. But a lot of them wait until I come back to that market to buy it from me again. I'm like, don't do that, please.
Well, they can order it too, right?
Yeah, of course.
I mean, that's kind of big. And also, so when you come here, I mean, is it, do you do better at shows that are independent comic based like this one, or like more entertainment based?
Yeah, definitely the comic shows are better. I actually find the smaller the show, the better I do.
Really?
And it's usually, like, the show has a lot of, I consider myself a solid mid-B level, creator level, like,
really?
Industry, maybe
that's
high B.
I would call you way higher, yeah.
Low A list? Okay, all right, whatever.
Wow.
No, so, you know, like, I like doing the bigger shows, like New York Comic Con and San Diego Comic Con, but there's a lot more competition. You know, you got like, you're sitting next to 40 other really well-known artists and writers. It's a little harder than when you go to say, like, I did really well at a show in Lexington, Kentucky. There was a show somewhere, I think in Virginia, called Comic-Con, Soda City. Some of these smaller shows I'll go on, I'll be like, I shouldn't say Virginia, but creator. But, you know, like, published by like a top five,
right.
10 creator.
You
know,
self-published.
Yeah. Well, I self-published, and what I call the regional heroes. Every show you go to, there's a few regional heroes.
True.
They're known in the local
market.
Yeah,
that totally makes sense. Yeah, that totally makes sense.
And they have a decent following locally.
Yeah.
You'll never hear of them anywhere else. And they haven't really branched out. And some of them branched out really well. Like, that's how the Bone guy, Jeff Smith, he used to be like a regional guy back in the early 90s. Then he just blew up into this massive national guy. So it does happen. You know, Bendis was the same way. He started out as kind of a regional self-publishing guy.
Is Bendis always important?
I don't remember. I think he was. I don't remember. But he used to, you know, he used to tour around doing Torso and some of these books that he self-published, like Fish, Jinx, back
Jinx.
In the day. Him and Dave Mack and some of these guys, they would always do these booths together. And then suddenly they become these big titans.
Yeah, like, so, he was part of it too. Yeah, I remember that whole thing.
The problem for me is it's really hard because Marvel and DC, they're not going to hire me because I'm an executive publisher that's driving them. So it makes it a little more difficult for me. Like a Brian Hill, who works with me on a lot of stuff, like he's writing for Marvel and DC now, and I think that's an easier road.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yep.
But you know, whatever. I'm not complaining.
But I mean, if it's worth doing, I mean, it's gonna be hard. So.
Yeah.
That's kind of like that's how it goes. And especially in this industry, nothing is ever easy. I don't think it is. Everything's always an uphill battle. But once you get there, it's fantastic.
Yeah, and you're good.
And it's beautiful, and you love it, and you never want to leave it. But it's still a consistent struggle, even when you're there. You got to stay on top. You have to keep producing that work. You got to keep, like, doing it.
Well, the key is to continue putting work out,
right.
You know, I mean, because once you build someone who likes to read your material, they want more material.
Right.
If you stop writing for a few years, you lose it. You know, it's, your flavor and you're gone. But that's why, you know, there's what I call the tail effect. Every new volume is something I put out in sales to somebody who's 4 years. So that's why three volumes seems to be the key number, actually. I try to do at least three volumes every time.
Three volumes,
very important.
Yes. So when you're at a convention like this, and obviously you're working the booths quite a lot, is there like a question that you get a lot that you're like,
alright. My favorite one is when I'm talking to them, they're like, oh, you're the writer. And they're like, yeah. I'm like, is this good? You know, and I'm like,
no,
it sucks, you know?
Spent all my life doing it.
I don't know how to answer that. I always say, it's fantastic. You'll love it. That's
fantastic.
My response. I say, you'll love it. It's
you'll
awesome.
It.
So you know what I used to do? Okay, so when people used to come to the booth and I had all the image titles that were all spread out, there was like 25 of them, I used to have to learn how to relate those titles to something else that was more popular.
Right.
Yeah.
And so you're like, oh, so what do you like to read? And they rattle off a whole bunch of books, and then I have to be like, oh, well, if you're a fan of that,
you'll
want to check out
this. Yeah. I do that too. Yeah, I do that all the time. Especially when they don't give me any sort of information. Because people will walk and they'll pick something up.
Right.
And I'm like, oh, that's this. Like, what's this about? Like, that's easy because I'll start talking.
Yeah, really, thanks.
But when they're just kind of standing there looking at me, I'm like,
what's
oh,
good?
Yeah, what do you read? And,
I love this.
Well, it's the worst ones for me.
Like,
is when people
one
say,
or two that's good, and I've read the other. Like, you're just like, okay, just this one is good, the rest of your is trash.
Just
like,
don't.
When people come by, they're like, oh, I just like Marvel.
Why are you here? What?
Like, that's fine.
Move along.
Yeah, exactly. So.
Keep moving.
And they were like, have you done any Marvel stuff? But then what do you say?
I say no.
You say no.
Well, I was listed as an editor on the Heroes Reborn stuff in the early 90s.
I remember that.
We did that. Rob and I made that deal. And then we got sued by Marvel for fighting America, and I got to slight Marvel for it back in 96, I think it was.
Wow.
That was fun.
Oh, wow.
That was one of my favorite comic stories. I remember showing up to court, and the Marvel's attorney at the time didn't know that Fighting American was a pre-existing character, that Joe Simon, the creator, had done this. So they said, this is Rob Liefeld kid created this Fighting American character, it's a rip-off of Captain America. And then we were like, no, here's the collected edition of the
40s. Sir, what you should see if you did your research.
Yeah. So it was what they had done. I'll never forget that. I don't think I've ever told this story. We served paperwork in the, we're in LA, and it was in New York the next day.
Oh my gosh,
wow. I got on a red eye flight, yeah. I flew in, I was delivered over to the court, and I presented, all I did was I took the Fighting American collected editions of Joe Simon, and I had the book, because we knew what their position was, and when I walked in and gave that book to our attorney that we hired, the judge immediately threw it out.
Nice.
And it worked out, and it was all fine after that. And then that
hold on to your comic books, folks.
Yeah. You never know. So.
Never know.
Wow. That's incredible.
Because if you think about it, it wasn't like the internet was really around to be able to research like that. Be like,
yeah.
The internet changed everything.
Let's talk about that. Like the Lady Pendragon book was the first comic I ever wrote. It took me 6 months to research, and I flew to England and took photos in Glastonbury and toured around and like talked to professors over there and took notes and like stuff. I did all this research. Now I could have done all that research in like 2 days.
Oh yeah. But he couldn't have had that visceral, like real life experience of it.
That's true.
No,
she's just gonna be like, are you? But also,
well, you want to go to England? I mean, come on.
Well, yeah, any excuse to go to England.
Yeah.
Especially in the name of research.
Yeah.
Write that shit off, right? Yeah. There you go.
Well, you got to incorporate these and pay for it. Companies don't write it off. You just pay for it. People think about that with writing offs. A lot of these research expenses are not write offs, they're technical company expenses. So you can actually just pay for it with company money. That's a good point.
Buy our shirts.
Merch.
Yeah. Merch.
That's sad. Okay. All right. Well, how are we doing?
We're good. Yeah.
I don't know what time it is. I have no concept of what's happening.
Oh, good. Okay.
Fantastic. All right, Matt. Is there anything that you want to promote?
Yeah. Is there anything you want to promote?
You know what I'm promoting here is my new book. Swing. It's a spinoff of Stephen Sage's Sunstone book, and it's about a couple that gets married. They get married really young. They have a couple kids, and they decide to practice and try swinging lifestyle. So it's kind of about ethical non-monogamy, and it's definitely a hard R book. So if you're squeamish of sex and nudity, then this is not for you. So, but
actually, before we go, there's something I wanted to bring up on the stream that you mentioned earlier, is that you do not like writing superheroes, period.
I never have. Yeah, I'm not a fan. I still like, I've never been a fan. I mean, I understand why people like them, but it's not for me. I've read a few superhero comics that I've enjoyed, but I don't seek them out.
But it's great, because a lot of people who are new to the comic book world or anything like that, they assume that every comic book is just superheroes, people in capes, this, that, the other. But like, all of your stuff is more like realistic, down-to-earth, like, real-life stories.
No, I like real characters and heightened situations. You know, I was a big fan of Michael Crichton and Isaac Asimov, and those are sort of the Piercy Anthony. That's how I kind of grew up with. So I like fantasy. I like I like real-world stuff. The movies I like are, I like real stuff.
Yeah.
You know, like, the movie Alien, scared me as a kid, but would never scare me as an adult. But the movie Hostel scared the fuck out of me as an adult.
I can't watch
Aliens.
Because you know someone somewhere is doing that, So it's just the idea of humans being monsters to each other is interesting.
Yeah. And also, I find, me personally, that books that are written like this, like Swing, are actually much more interesting to me because it's about a human condition and it's not made up. And it hits you. And there's people out there who
real life experience.
It's a real life experience. Like, yeah. They either see themselves in it or learn something that they did not know before, which is the whole. And, you know, it opens eyes, I think. Yes. And, you know, leads to greater acceptance.
Yeah, yes. I've you know, I taught briefly, and so I've always liked the idea of sort of clandestinely educating or entertaining. Uh-huh. You know, so most of the stuff I pick has some sort of I like to make people think, you know, and so I usually tell people that if you're just looking for pure escapist entertainment, that you're not going to like my stuff. You know, and I just tell people that I'm just honest with you. There's no point selling someone a book that they're not going to like.
So is it good? Are you an escapist? Then keep walking.
Let's
go.
Yeah. But what are some of the other books that you've done?
Think Tank, Postal, The Tithe, Symmetry, Golgotha. I'm doing a new book called Stairway that's already out digitally via the Kickstarter, but hasn't come out in print yet. Of everything I've done in the last year, I think Swing and Stairway are my two favorites.
Yeah.
And Sugar is a new book that Yishun Lee and I did, which is a spinoff of Swing. It's kind of a modern day Pretty Woman. And that'll be out in August. Well, Stairway and Sugar will be out in August. I don't know why I'm so stuck on the S's right now. Swing, Sugar, I don't know. That just kind of happened. But Sugar is essentially, I wanted to do something about, because we started doing this sex positive, sex subculture stuff. Like Sunstone is S&M,
right,
Swinging is a swing lifestyle, like ethical non-monogamy. Sugar is about a girl and an older man that get into kind of a sugar baby and sugar daddy relationship. And so the question is, how do you write a book like that that's not creepy and weird? And so we finally figured out a way that this is the first time the girl's ever really done it. It's the first time he's ever really done it, and they only do it together, and it's this whole, and they fall in love. And so it's just, but it's there's a reason why it's like she opposes it because they start to get together, but he's in a divorce or a woman, and so he's kind of emotionally unavailable. So he offers her this as a make good. And it's hard to explain, but it's one of those things that it's a fun book, and it really is. I got to say, Yishun's art on it really blows my mind.
Really?
I mean, it is fantastic. You want to see a little bit of art?
I do.
Yes,
I do.
See it. Yeah, we totally have time. We always have time for art, right, guys? All right, while he's looking that up, Eric says he'd like to know more about comic book artists and writers, and then he met...
Mark McKenna, Mark.
Last weekend, who worked on Marvel Comics, yeah.
I have worked with Mark on Banana Tail. So if you saw that book on his table.
Look at this.
Ooh.
That's a spread out of
Did you guys see?
But you can see, like... You know, basically the story. And this is the original graphic novel. It's 110 pages of original graphic novel. It's only $10. So you know, you got a girl who's hardworking. She's young. She's trying to go to college.
Nice.
And
as you do, the artwork is fantastic.
So you can see Yishun. I don't know if you can show that here.
No.
But you see kind of what they're doing. They meet up at one of her jobs, and then they kind of get her situation, his situation. So he's trying to. His friend is trying to get him to date. And he's the one that suggests his friend you can see like half the page there. Yeah. But that's one of the, by the way, that's one of the two autographs only ever in my life I've ever got.
I was actually noticing these.
That's Dr. Michio Kaku.
Oh.
And that's me. I wrote it to see from the work.
I was making sure that
the only other autograph I've ever asked for in my life was Sean Connery 20 years ago.
Oh, wow.
So I have,
I have
both.
I would do that. Yes. I would get that.
You know what? That story kind of reminds me of Shop Girl with Steve Martin. Did you ever read
Shop
his book? It was a novel that was on the bestseller list. It was written by Steve Martin, and it's about himself having a relationship with a much younger shop girl.
Huh.
And it's really good. It was made into a movie that starred him.
Right.
And,
they really avoided
creepiness.
Yeah, 100%
did.
No, we went really out to, like, this is a sugar baby party, and you can see, like, she's not there. But this is him, his friend made him go, so he's trying to do it, and then he realizes he doesn't like it, so he leaves the party and goes, and she's working at this bar. She tells him earlier she works at this bar, so he goes in and sees her, and then he sees her boss slap her on the ass kind of thing.
Yeah.
So he yells at the boss, he gets thrown out, and she goes with him, because he stood up.
What's the age difference?
She's 24, I think he's...
Oh, that's okay.
I'm dating
more than that.
Well, I almost married more than that, fine.
I'm 48, my wife's 30.
Yeah, okay.
We're 14 years, I don't know.
But I only have a 6-year age difference with mine. Yes.
I have none.
Yes. But
you did have a 12-year
really
one.
16.
I did. Yeah.
There was one that I dated in New York that was 18-year difference.
I had a 20-year one.
Yeah.
Really?
We're finding out a lot about each other.
Am I okay?
Anyways.
So the only weird thing about that, dating someone that's much younger, I say it's a guy and you guys are younger girls, is there are times when my wife won't know what I'm talking about.
100%.
Like a pop culture reference.
100%.
Like, do you know what an e-ticket ride is?
E-ticket? Yeah, I remember that.
Do you remember that? Like, it's Disneyland back in the day. They used to sell, you'd buy tickets. You wouldn't do like a pass to go on. Back in the 70s, when you do it at Disneyland, you'd buy a ticket to ride and you'd get an e-ticket. And those were for the good rides. And so they would call an e-ticket ride to be like, it would be like the good ride. So you want to go on the Matterhorn, you'd use an e-ticket. You have the regular tickets for the other rides. So I made a comment to my wife, and it's happened today. I'm like, yeah, it's like an e-ticket ride. She's like, what?
What? Luckily, my boyfriend's an 80s buff, so I don't have to worry when I talk about that. He thinks I grew up in the Breakfast Club, which is kind of great, even though I didn't. But it's cool.
Is he younger?
Yes.
How much?
6 years, only six.
Oh, only six?
Yeah.
Have either one of you dated a guy that's 10 years younger?
No.
Never ever? That'd be interesting.
I just went older. I went 20 years older.
Yeah, I've only gotten older.
That's because of maturity, you know.
It
women
is.
Mature faster than men,
exactly.
So it's kind of hard to. Like, my wife and I joke, we're about emotionally the same maturity.
Yep.
Yeah,
it goes.
Totally.
Yep. And my boyfriend was like a young old man. So
yeah, there you go.
That's exactly how to describe Marcus. There you go.
Yep. Cool.
Well, guys, thank
thanks,
you for
guys.
Joining.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, amazing Las Vegas Comic Con, for having us, and we'll see you next week.
Next week. Thanks, guys.
Bye, guys.